Welcome to this Lightroom Basics tutorial. My name is WolfArmory, Wolf.Armory on Instagram, and in this video I will show you some insider tips on all the great input features in Lightroom, and also share some insight on how I manage my images in general. First and foremost, let me explain how I use Lightroom. I'm a professional photographer, so I shoot a lot of images. I like to have them all organized, so I create a new Lightroom catalog for every shooting. Let's do that. I go to File, New Catalog. Usually, if I plan to work on a lot of images, I save it on a fast hard drive to speed up the process. Only when I'm done with that catalog, I move it to a slower archive drive. So I'll save it here on my external SSD. I name it year, month, and a descriptive name for the shooting. That way, the shootings will be automatically sorted by date. And if I use the search function on Mac on the Finder or on Windows in the File Explorer, I'll quickly find the images without searching for hours. Talking about hard drives, consider backups of your hard drives because they can fail. Or let me say it differently, they do fail. I have a different video on backup strategies if you're interested. Back on track, we have created our Lightroom catalog. Before we import our first images, let me quickly tell you how Lightroom works. Lightroom is based on a database. The changes you make will be saved in a database and not in the image itself. That means it is non-destructive. And that's one of the reasons why I prefer it to, for example, Photoshop for most of my work. What sounds complicated is actually rather easy. Let's say you edit your images, changing some of the sliders. Lightroom only saves the position of the sliders in a database. It doesn't change the raw file on your hard drive. And the next time you open Lightroom, you can easily undo the changes or change them again without sacrificing the quality of your images. The base is still a raw file, so you will always work on the raw file. Either way, now it's about time to get some files into our database, or in other words, import them into Lightroom. There are in fact a few ways to do that. Do not make this video too long. I will only explain the one that I feel works best. On my system, when I have Lightroom open and insert a card into the card reader, the input dialog will automatically pop up, which is really handy. If it doesn't for you, or if it does and you hate it, here is how to change that in Lightroom's preferences. I go to Lightroom Preferences, and in the General tab under Import Options, check the box at Show Input Dialog when a memory card is detected. So now when we insert a card into the card reader, the input dialog will pop up. But let's close that again, because what if I already inserted the card before I started Lightroom? Then I click the Import button down here, which is only available in the Library module. So make sure Library is selected up on top here. We will soon get to the other modes and you love them, but let's first import our images. So I click Import and usually the window would look like this. However, I had somebody desperately looking for help in our Facebook group because his input dialog looked like this. So, let me carve this into your mind. Whenever the Lightroom interface looks weird, watch out for triangles that could act as buttons. They show and hide content on places you wouldn't imagine they existed. That little info can save you hours of time, so keep that in mind. So I'll click that rectangle to get back to the standard import screen. Now let's see what we want to import and where we want to import it to. Right on top you will see from on the left and to on the right. Let's start with the from. Usually Lightroom detects the memory card and automatically selects it on this side. If it doesn't, or you want to import files that already exist on your hard drive, you can select the source of your import here. If you click on any of the folders on your hard drive, Lightroom will automatically show all the images in that folder and in the subfolders if you check this box on top. But let's select our card again and include the subfolder. But you can fine-tune even more which images from the card are displayed here. Up here you have three options. First, all photos. Pretty self-explanatory. Next is new photos. Sounds self-explanatory too, right? You would assume these are all the images that are not yet imported into your catalog. Let me show you. I have already imported the first two images into the catalog, but weirdly, when I change between all photos and new photos, nothing changes. Only if I check this box here, don't import suspected duplicates, will they suddenly disappear from the grid under new photos or will become grayed out in the all photos list of images. That might be a bit confusing. That's why I hardly ever use the new photos view. We will discuss the next display option, the destination folder view, in a few minutes. This is really useful, but I want to do this as structured as possible. Now that you understand what images are displayed, I'm going to show you how to select the images you want to import. Right here, you see the checkbox All Photos. I usually import all photos from a card or shooting and then pick and delete while editing, rather than selecting them here. But let's consider you only want one or two files from that card in this particular catalog. I can uncheck the All Photos box and select a few like this and that. You may wonder why I have to click on the small checkbox rather than on the large thumbnails to select an image. Seems rather cumbersome, but there is a secret reason behind that. I can highlight multiple files by using the Control or Command key and clicking on the images, or even click on the first one and then shift click on the last one. And now I can just click on one of the checkboxes to change it for all the highlighted ones. Okay. Now that we have selected some of the images, let's discuss what we can do with them. Up on the very top, you have several options. The first one is copy as DNG. Camera manufacturers have different RAW file formats, ARW, NRW, CR3, and so on. Adobe has its own RAW format called DNG, and they claim to be future-proof. If you select this option, your RAW files will be converted to DNG on import. I usually don't use that. On a side note, if your camera is very new, Lightroom might not be able to read your files. Then you can download Adobe's DNG converter. With that, you can convert the files from your camera to DNG, and then Lightroom will easily be able to input and edit them. The option copy will leave the image where it is and add a copy to the destination folder. We will discuss that in a minute. The option move will move the original image to the destination folder. If you import the image from a memory card, this option and the following will be grayed out. And the last option is add. This option will leave the original file at its current location and Lightroom will only reference to that file in the database. As I said, won't work for files you input from a memory card. Let's next change to the bottom here. Lightroom tells you how many images you've selected for import and the file size of that bunch. Here you can select the view, grid view or larger view. For the import, I never use the larger view. Then I again have check all or uncheck all. Don't know why that is placed twice, but these buttons here serve another function. If your card contains videos too, pressing the Alt or Option key on your keyboard will change the text on this button and you can uncheck all the videos on the card. Lightroom is not a video editing software, so I usually import videos in a different application and I also store them separately from my photos. Okay, on to the next item here, the sort. I don't really use it, but maybe it is helpful for you. And next, the thumbnail size, which can be nice when looking at different sized screens. Then we continue to the right side. On top you can read 2. So on the right side is all the info about the destination. This whole thing here is a button. In fact, a drop-down with shortcuts for some popular destinations. For example, your desktop, your images folder, or a custom one you can specify. This can be handy when you often import into the same folder. Below that, we have another drop-down that lets us choose what preview size we want. Depending on what you choose here, Lightroom will react slower when you later browse through your images or quicker. The smallest preview is up on top, It will use the least disk space, but you may feel that Lightroom is a bit laggy during editing. The further you get down, the bigger the previews are. They take up more space, but Lightroom will react faster during editing and move from one image to the next. But it takes longer to render the bigger previews on import, so if you're like me and after a shoot you want quick access to the imported files rather than wait until the one-to-one previews are processed, you better leave it on standard, which I normally do. Ticking the checkbox below will build smart previews. When we have previews, why do we need smart previews? Well, if you have your Lightroom catalog on your computer's hard drive and your images on an external hard drive, you can still work on the files even if your external hard drive is not connected. Is that helpful? Maybe, but it takes a lot of disk space. So it depends on you if you want to check that or not. I usually have the Lightroom catalog on the same place as my images, so it doesn't make sense for me. We have already discussed the next one, don't import suspected duplicates. If Lightroom thinks a file already exists in your catalog, it will not import it if this box is checked. Then you can choose to make a backup of the imported files by saving a second copy on a different location. That will be handy if you're on a wedding or all of your cards are full, which shouldn't happen by the way, and you have to format the card after the import. I usually don't use it because I keep the memory cards that are full until I'm back in the office and my computer has backed up all the files. Below that, you can select whether you want to add the images to a collection on import. I will introduce you to collections in another video, but this can be really handy if you, unlike me, have one Lightroom catalog for all your images. You could, for example, create a collection here by clicking on the plus icon and naming it, I don't know, 2021 bird photos. And then you later will have faster access to all the bird photos of that year by selecting your collection. Okay, next tab in Lightroom is the file renaming tab. I always rename my files by date, so my choice is date file name. But you might want to choose something different here, for example, shoot name sequence. Then you can enter a shoot name and a start number for the sequence here. Down below you will see an example of how the files will be renamed. As I said, I use date because sometimes when I export files in a folder, for example, to upload it to the web, and then forget the folder I put it in, I can always search for the date and pretty quickly find all the images from that date. You can of course do that as you want, but I strongly recommend to stay consistent. You can click on Edit and use totally creative file names. They won't help you though if you don't remember them, and they can also get pretty long. When you open them in Definer or Workbox Explorer, you have to extend the files of the column. And one more, if you forget to change that on your next import, that is not, for example, about bird photos, you will then rename all your sports images 2021 bird photos. Been there, done that, no more. So that's my recommendation, but think about it a bit and come up with your own consistent system. The last drop down in the file rename tab, let me choose whether I want the file name extension all uppercase letters or lowercase or leave as is. I usually leave it as is because I don't see an advantage in this. The next tab can save you quite a bit of time. First, I can choose whether I want to add a develop setting to the files. I like to do that because for all files I import, I want to remove chromatic aberration, and I also like to add a bit of saturation and vibrance. What is chromatic aberration? It is that ugly purple or green fringe you sometimes get in the corner of images when there is a lot of contrast. That is really ugly, and there is no reason why you should keep it in your images. Thanks to Kathy Payne-Doughty for letting me use her otherwise awesome image. So at best, you make sure it is removed right on import. So here you can just choose Optics CA Correction. You can even create a custom preset for this, including more saturation, contrast and whatnot. We'll get to presets in a later video, but personally, I have a general import preset that I use. But if you, for example, have a smartphone and a dedicated camera, you can use separate import presets depending on what adjustments you want to make on either. More on that in a later video. The next tab is Add Metadata. For those of you who like to add watermarks to protect their images, you can add copyright information and other things into the metadata, or in other words, invisible data of the file. I have an import preset that includes that copyright information and a way for people to contact us. So I can choose the preset I made, copyright Amri Photo. If you want to create your own, you can choose new, give the preset a name, let's say copyright import, fill out the fields that you want and hit create. And now you can select it in the dropdown and automatically add that to all the imported images. Next are keywords. It helps find images when you, unlike me, have all images in one Lightroom catalog. So if your images show birds, you can type in birds. Here I could add vacation, Seychelles, travel. This metadata is also stored in your files when you export them from Lightroom, so you can again use the Finder or File Explorer to search for these keywords. And now we get to the final and perhaps most important tab, the destination. I would highly recommend to save the images in the same folder as you save the catalog. Remember, that was what we started with when we created the catalog. Lightroom created a folder for that, and this is our destination. Here you see all the hard drives and cards on your system. I have a lot, as you can see, so don't let that confuse you. I'll just go to the folder that was created and highlight that. But now we're going to do something that I'd highly recommend. Up here, under Organize, I'd recommend choosing By Date. That will create folders for every date, as you can see here. You can choose a date format for that folder in the next dropdown, and you can even choose a subfolder when you tick that box. And for example, since these are hiking photos, I could name that subfolder Hiking. The folder will then appear right here, and that again gives you even more control, or better said, organization of your content. And now I owe you one thing I really love about Lightroom. I told you, I sometimes forget the form of the card after I already imported the images. I usually do that in camera, but let's say I have files on the card that I already imported into this or any other catalog. Remember the destination folders up here. Since we have chosen to organize by date here in the destination tab, when I now select destination folders up here, the images on the card are grouped by date. Let me quickly reduce the thumbnail size so that you can better see it. And that let me easily unselect my images of dates that I have already imported before. The only downside of that is there is a bug in Lightroom that consists for quite a while now. If I uncheck the box here, it will unselect all the images for that date, but it will still keep the box checked. But don't worry, as long as the images are unselected down here, nothing will be imported. Once you unchecked, you could even collapse the images for that date by clicking on the triangle here. You will also see that in the destination tab, the dates will be unchecked or grayed out. So that too is a great way of selecting the images from a certain day. And one more thing, if you want to eject the card after the images are imported, you can tick the box on the top left. And now all we have to do is press the import button on the bottom right to import the selected images into our catalog and onto the hard drive. See you in the next lesson, where the fun really starts.